Thanks, Julie. It'd be great if you keep your Bibles open to that part of God's Word. I'd actually like to begin this morning by showing you a clip from a movie, but what I want to hear from you is, where is this clip from, and can you tell me what it's about? So let's have a look at this clip right now. There you go. Okay, let's go. Who could tell me anything about that clip?
Notting
Hill. Thank you, Matthew. You go straight to the bottom of the class. Anyway, any other suggestions out there what that clip's from?
Star Wars.
It's Star Wars. Which one?
Return of the Jedi.
It's called Attack of the Clones. It's otherwise known as Episode 2. Which was really number one. It's the fifth one that was made, okay? And can you tell me what's happening in that scene? Anakin and Padme are getting married. Anakin Skywalker and Padme Amidalis are getting married, hitched. Now, some of you might be very unfamiliar with that scene. You know, looking at it, go, what is that all about? You might have got a few clues from seeing C-3PO and R2-D2 and you think, oh, that's a Star Wars movie. I can tell that much. But, you know, from that union, they would go on to have twins. Those twins are Luke and Leia Skywalker, who become the heroes of the other movies. And Anakin Skywalker, the groom in that scene, he goes on to become Darth Vader, okay? Now, the reason why I've shown it to you is because it's really to help us to understand that the significance of a scene in a movie, it really helps to know where it fits in the larger story, doesn't it? Okay? It's a bit hard to figure out what that scene's about, but once you put it in the larger picture, you can begin to understand the significance of that scene, what it means. And what is true of just watching a scene out of Star Wars like that is also true of the Bible when we read it. So we've just had a passage from the Bible read for us. It's like a scene, but it's part of a larger story, and it'll actually help us to understand the significance of this scene when we see it fits into the larger story of the Bible. So let's have a look at verses 1 and 2, where we discover really what is the tragedy behind success in our passage today. Okay, the tragedy behind success. Verse 1. The word of the Lord came to Hosea, son of Beeri, during the reign of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, during the reign of Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, king of Israel. Now, first of all, what we have in that one verse is we're told what sort of scripture we're reading. We're actually reading prophecy here, because here we're introduced to a prophet of God's people with the words, "The word of the Lord came to Hosea." Now, the prophets in Israel, they were God's mouthpieces. They were there to proclaim God's word to God's people. In fact, the Apostle Peter in the New Testament says of prophecy in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. It says, "For prophecy never had its origin in human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." That's how they did their ministry of prophecy, of bringing God's word. Now, altogether, there are 17 prophetic books in the Bible, and they cover different periods of God's history with his saved people Israel. And the two major themes that you will find in every prophetic book is the theme of judgment and the theme of hope. They are the two major themes that you'll see in any book, prophetic book of the Bible. And these themes of judgment and hope are based on God's promises, on God's commitment or the covenant that he made with his people Israel. Now, as you look at verse 1, you can also see that there are two kingdoms mentioned, can't you? Okay? Now, we see that there's the kingdom of Judah and then there's the kingdom of Israel. Now, what's that telling? That what that is telling us is that we have moved on from the glory days of King David and King Solomon, who ruled over the united 12 tribes of Israel. You see, after King Solomon's 40-year reign ended, the 10 northern tribes, they rebelled against Solomon's son Rehoboam's harsh rule, okay? And so they became the kingdom of Israel in the north. And they were living under a new king by the name of Jeroboam, not the Jeroboam we're reading in our passage today, okay? So Jeroboam is now ruling over the kingdom of Judah, the kingdom of Israel, while Rehoboam, Solomon's son, he's looking after the two southern tribes in the kingdom of Judah. Now, you've got these two sort of kingdoms now, okay? And Jerusalem is in the southern kingdom, okay? It's not in the northern kingdom. Jerusalem and the temple's in the southern kingdom. Now, so that the people living in the north didn't have to travel to Judah, to the kingdom of Judah, to Jerusalem, to the temple, what King Jeroboam did was he set up two golden calves, okay? Now, as soon as you say that, you think, this isn't going to go well. Okay, we're already about the golden calves during the Exodus. Well, he sets up two golden calves in Israel, one in the south in Bethel and one in the north in a place called Dan. And Jeroboam declared that to Israel that these are the gods that rescued you from slavery in Egypt. And it's this sin of Jeroboam that would become the besetting sin in the life of Israel that will bring them undone. The other thing to notice about verse 1, though, is that during Hosea's ministry, Israel, the kingdom of Israel, actually enjoys an unprecedented time of political stability. Did you notice that they only have one king during this time? It's Jeroboam II, okay? Whereas Judah's been a bit like Australia, okay? They've had four kings, okay? So Israel's enjoying this political stability. In fact, you can look up 2 Kings chapter 14, where you can learn about Jeroboam's 41-year reign. It's during his reign that Israel actually flourishes. If there's ever a golden period of the kingdom of Israel, it is during King Jeroboam's time. It's during his time that the borders of Israel are restored. It's during that time that Jeroboam recovered the cities of Damascus and Hamath from the rival kingdom of Judah. And you know what? They enjoy all this success. All this success, even when Israel are choosing to worship other gods rather than the God who saved them. Now, what's going on there? Why are they enjoying so much success and at the same time ignoring the God who saved them? Is it that God can't see what they're doing? Or is it that God doesn't care what Israel's doing? Huge success, but idolatry at the same time. Well, God then drops a bombshell in verse 2. Look at it with me. Then the Lord began to speak through Hosea. The Lord said to him, "Go marry a promiscuous woman and have children with her, for like an adulterous wife, this land is guilty of unfaithfulness to the Lord." So here, God is holding up a mirror to the kingdom of Israel. He wants them to help them see what it is like for God to be their God. That being the God of Israel is like Hosea being married to a promiscuous woman. It's, you know, when you read the Old Testament prophets, from time to time the Old Testament prophets are encouraged to do something to illustrate the message that that's being brought to the people. And here, Hosea has to act out God's message to Israel. And it really is a shocking image. In fact, I think our translation in the NIV here actually softens it a bit as to just how stark that verse really is. Just listen to the Jerusalem translation of that verse. The beginning of what Yahweh said through Hosea. Yahweh said to Hosea, go marry a whore and get children with a whore, for the country itself has become nothing but a whore by abandoning Yahweh. It's hardly the language that you'd expect in the Bible. But there it is. Israel has committed spiritual adultery. They have been caught in bed with other gods. And Hosea's traumatic marriage is being used to remind Israel that despite their seeming success, there is a very disturbing reality of the fact that they have betrayed the one who loved them and saved them. You know, in their political life, Israel, the kingdom of Israel, didn't look to God for help and hope. No, they looked for alliances with other pagan nations around them to try and secure their borders. And in terms of their moral life, again, they didn't bother looking towards God for direction. Violent crimes were being committed and sexual taboos were being crossed, all of them damaging human relationships within Israel during this flourishing time of Israel's history. And their religious life is marred by idolatry that came from the formation of the kingdom of Israel. And it's being led from the front by their religious leaders, this idolatry. So God calls on Hosea to marry this promiscuous woman to help Israel see what they are doing to God. All too often I think, well, we can think that when we sin in our life, when we know that we've done the wrong thing, I think sometimes we think, you know, we're breaking some sort of impersonal, arbitrary rule that God has sort of set up. You know, it's on some dusty tablets of stone, or, you know, some rule that's written in a dusty scroll. But here we are reminded that we are not simply breaking some impersonal rule when we sin. We're actually breaking God's heart when we defy him, when we betray him, when we find something else in our life to take center stage rather than God himself. And sometimes those things that consume our life and control our life and our life's decisions can be good things in and of themselves. You know, our family or our home or our careers or our financial security. All those things are good things. Don't get me wrong. I'm not going down on them. But they are not worthy of our first allegiance, which belongs to God alone. And when things are all going well in our own lives, when all of us here are kicking goals and no success, it can actually blind us to our own defiance and betrayal of God, of our own spiritual adultery, because maybe we've started to think, God really can't see what I'm doing, or God doesn't really mind. But God does mind. That brings us to the second point in our passage, that this sort of relationship simply does not have a future. In verses 3 to 8, we see how Hosea's marriage actually warns Israel that their present betrayal of God does not have a future. Look at verses 3 and 4 of our passage today. So he married Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. Then the Lord said to Hosea, call him Jezreel, because I will soon punish the house of Jehu for the massacre at Jezreel, and I will put an end to the kingdom of Israel. In that day I will break Israel's bow in the valley of Jezreel. Here, God tells Hosea to name his firstborn son Jezreel. Jezreel means God scatters. And at Jezreel, Jeroboam's ancestor, okay, King Jehu, actually slaughtered all those who were associated with King Ahab and King Ahab's house. All these people who stood as rivals to King Jehu were slaughtered. And the massacre is actually recorded in 2 Kings chapter 10. See, Hosea naming his son Jezreel would be like somebody naming their son today Port Arthur, where Australia experienced its worst massacre. Or calling their son Twin Towers, where thousands were murdered on 9/11. This son that is born to Hosea would remind everyone that God has not forgotten the murderous slaughter in Jezreel. As Ahab's house was wiped out, so Israel will be wiped out. Justice will be done. God has not forgotten what happened at Jezreel. Hosea's wife, Gomer, goes on to have a second child, a daughter. But did you notice we're not even sure whether this might be Hosea's daughter or not? Okay? It's not clear. It may well be, it might not be. But look at verses 6 and 7. Gomer conceived again and gave birth to a daughter. Then the Lord said to Hosea, call her Lo-Ruhamah, which means not loved. For I will no longer show love to Israel, that I should at all forgive them. Yet I will show love to Judah, and I will save them, not by bow, sword, or battle, or by horses or horsemen, but I, the Lord their God, will save them. You know, often we hear about the strange names that celebrities can give their children. I actually looked them up on the internet during the week. I'd forgotten, but do you remember how Nicole Kidman and Keith Urban called their daughter Sunday? I think it was Sunday Rose, and everyone's calling her Sunday Roast or something like that. Or the musician Frank Zappa called his daughter Moon Unit. Imagine having that as a name, Moon Unit. But imagine calling your daughter Not Loved. But this was to give a message to Israel. And the message was this: for I will no longer show love to Israel, that I should at all forgive them. You see, Israel has crossed a line. In fact, they've been crossing this line for centuries. Time and time again, they have abandoned God and gone after false gods. And God, in the past, has patiently borne with them, forgiven them, but not anymore. And so in 722 BC, the nation of Assyria would sweep down and completely destroy the northern kingdom of Israel. Judgment will be done, but the southern kingdom, the kingdom of Judah, it will be spared. But a bit more of a century afterwards, Judah would be gone as well. Now you'd think it couldn't get much worse for Israel, but it does. Gomer has another child, a son. And again, we're not sure whether this is Hosea's child or not. Look at verses 8 and 9. After she'd weaned Lo-Ruhamah, Gomer had another son. Then the Lord said, call him Lo-Ami, which means not my people. For you are not my people, and I am not your God. Can you see how Israel's attitude towards God would finally reap the reality of who they really are? You know, when the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt, God said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. When Moses confronted Pharaoh with God's message, Moses said, this is what the Lord says, let my people go so that they may worship me. When the Israelites received God's law before they entered into the promised land, God would say to them, I will walk among you and be your God, and you will be my people. But the naming of this child was symbolic, and it was saying to Israel, it's over. So as Hosea would walk down the main street of Bethel with his three children, God would be saying to all Israel, remember Jezreel, not loved, not my people. Now, none of this should have been any surprise to Israel. You know, before their ancestors even entered into the promised land, this is what the prophet Moses said to them as the generation was about to move into the promised land, from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 15. See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you'll certainly be destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. All Hosea is doing in this passage is he is announcing the judgment that was already established in God's covenant with his saved people before they entered into the promised land. And it's these messages of judgment, I think all of us, including myself, we don't like to hear them. They're hard to hear. A message that says that you and I, that we will be held accountable for the life that we have lived before God. And I actually think that this is a message that I need to certainly feel the weight of, as do you. Listen to what the writer of the Hebrews said to Christians. It comes from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning of verse 26. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we've received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sin is left, but only a fearful expectation of the judgment and of a raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejects the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? Do you feel the weight of those words? God's words to Israel through the prophet Hosea were not an idle threat. In 722 BC, the nation of Assyria wiped not my people off the map. And we hear these words of warning in the pages of the New Testament. What they should do for us is to shock any sort of complacency that we might have in our life and how we think about sin in our own lives. But they ought not to move us to darkness and despair. I think those warnings are there to help us to seek out help and hope, because we all need it. And so that brings us to the final point of our passage, that the future is not without mercy. Have a look at these final verses of our passage today, beginning at verse 10. Yet the Israelites will be like the sand on the seashore, which cannot be measured or counted. In the place where it is said to them, you are not my people, they will be called children of the living God. The people of Judah and the people of Israel will come together. They will appoint one leader and will come up out of the land, for great will be the day of Jezreel. Say of your brothers, my people, and of your sisters, my loved one. See, here in these verses, we're reminded of the God who will not let us go. That while we may have broken our vows to him, he will not break his vows to us. Sure, judgment will come, But that will not be the end. God will keep his unconditional promises that he made to Abraham to bless the world through him. And so God will keep his promise of many descendants to Abraham that no one will count. God will restore the relationship of not my people to become children of the living God. God will usher in a new unity for these divided kingdoms to become one. And then God will raise up a new leader from within this kingdom, a descendant of David. And then God will bring about a new exodus or salvation out of the land. And then God will restore not my people to my people, and not loved to my loved one. Now the question is, how can God do this? How can God deliver just judgment and then the undeserved blessing of mercy? How can he do that? Well, the answer actually came 760 years after Hosea began his prophetic ministry. As the Lord Jesus Christ entered into our fallen and broken world, he came into our world as the faithful Israelite. You see, Jesus was everything that Israel failed to be. He was utterly faithful to his heavenly Father. Sure, he was tempted with spiritual idolatry. Okay? When he was taken into the desert for those 40 days, Jesus felt the full force of being tempted with spiritual adultery, but he never gave into it. In fact, Jesus longed to do the will of his heavenly Father, even to the point of death. That means that he didn't deserve the judgment of God for his unfaithfulness. And yet when he goes to the cross, he bears the judgment of God. But it's not for his own infidelity. It's for yours and it's for mine. He faces the judgment we deserve so that we don't have to. So that anyone can now come running to Jesus in true repentance and faith, and you can be absolutely sure that you can be completely forgiven. Forgiven from those sins committed in the past that still haunt the back of your mind. Or those sins that are weighing heavily on your conscience right now. They can be completely dealt with and forgiven by Jesus, because he has died in our place so that we can be known to God as my people and my loved one. You know what, for most of my life, I think marriage has had a very awkward place in our Western culture. For many years as I was growing up, most people were saying, you know what, marriage, it really is an outmoded institution that adds very little to people's pursuit of happiness today. A lot of people used to just say, you know, marriage is just a piece of paper. You know, that's all it is. In fact, marriage would be dismissed in the past with lines such as, marriage is the only game of chance where both sides can lose. But in recent years, that's changed, hasn't it? In recent years, marriage has gained an importance. It's become a badge that legitimizes any sort of committed relationship between two people. Well, in our passage today, there are two marriages. There is the traumatic marriage between Hosea and Gomer that reflects the traumatic marriage relationship between God and the northern kingdom of Israel, a relationship that was marred by spiritual adultery. And yet, you'd think that given this troubled imagery with marriage and that, you know, you might find another image to describe the relationship between God's people and God. But actually, the image of marriage between God and his people is actually found at the very end of the Bible as well. In Revelation chapter 21, we read these words. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God." In that passage, at the very end of history, the church is described as the beautifully dressed bride for her husband. Now the question is, how is that possible given your failures and my failures? How can we possibly be so beautifully dressed for our husband, Jesus? You know, I've conducted a lot of marriages here at St. Luke's, and I actually think, you know, that moment when the groom and the bride exchange rings with one another, it actually helps us to understand how we can be beautifully dressed given our own circumstances. You know, it's when the bride and the groom exchange rings and they say to each other, "With all that I am and all that I have, I honour you." I think those words actually give us an insight. It's an odd phrase, but what it means is that whatever I am and whatever I have, I entrust or I give to you. It is to pay honour to the other person by giving ourselves and giving all that we have to them. And so when any of us come to Jesus in true repentance and faith, it is like that moment in the marriage service. We come to Jesus and give him all that we have to offer for this relationship. The filthy rags of our own sinful rebellion and failure, or even our own self-righteousness. That's what we give to the relationship. And then Jesus gives us all that we need for this relationship. His blood for our pardon and his perfect righteousness to clothe our failure. As we've looked at the prophet Hosea, he's shown us a dark moment in the life of God's people, the dark reality of infidelity and the judgment that will follow. But here we've also seen hope. Hope in God's faithfulness. And we finally see that hope resolved in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who turns us to become my people and my loved one. Let's pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we've been floored by this passage today and what it has to say to us in the face of our own infidelity towards you, for the way that we've replaced you with other things in our life that don't deserve your central position. Heavenly Father, forgive us for that. And thank you for the help and hope that we have in Jesus, that we are able to give to him our sin and failure, and that he's able to give us by his blood our pardon, and that he's able to give us his robe of righteousness to cover our failures. Heavenly Father, help us to heed the warning of what happened to your people Israel. Help us to continue to press on in repentance and faith so that we might be found to belong to that great city that comes from heaven, the bride beautifully dressed for her husband, and that we might indeed know that you are with us and that we are indeed your people. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.